A stent is placed in an artery as part of a procedure called angioplasty. But when did the development of stents start? We spoke with Dr. Robert Bernstein at Desert Regional Medical Center in Palm Springs. He explores the history of stents.
The first stents which were developed were actually called bailout stents, started in the 80s, and were designed that if you got acute closure and you already had the wire down the vessel, you could slip this stent in and it would scaffold and open the artery up enough so the patient wasn't having a heart attack and you had time then to take the patient to the operating room without them having some major catastrophe on the way. And then elective stenting came along a few years later to try to treat the problem of restenosis. So when we first started putting in the elective stents, the recurrence rate or the restenosis rate with the scar tissue inside the vessel went down from 40 to 50% to about 20%. So that was a giant leap forward in terms of trying to get to the Achilles heel of stenting, which is restenosis or the scar tissue. The big development was the placement of drugs that stop proliferation of cells on the stent itself, and these are called drug-eluting stents, and that was the big leap. That took the restenosis rate down from 20% to about 5%, and that was a major breakthrough. But the problem that came up that was unexpected was that because the drugs prevented proliferation of the tissues, these metal stents would stay in there for months and months and wouldn't get covered up by normal tissue. And as long as you have a foreign body in the artery that's not covered up by the normal tissue that we call endothelium, there was a risk for a blood clot forming on the stent. The current recommendation of the American Heart Association and the American College of Cardiology that patients who have a drug-eluting stent stay on dual antiplatelet therapy, aspirin and one of these other antiplatelet drugs, for about a year. The next strive was to try to see how quickly we could get people off dual antiplatelet therapy and still be safe. And now people are thinking with the second generation stents, it's probably going to be 3 to 6 months, which is a big help.
Stent procedures have replaced many heart surgeries.
Now, the American College of Cardiology has guidelines for when somebody should get an elective stent. There's no question that putting in a stent for an acute heart attack can be life-saving and is the way to go. It's been proven that it's better than clot-busting drugs or regular medical therapy or emergency surgery. That's the way to go if you're having a heart attack and you get to the hospital within 6 hours. If you have chest pain, there also are recent trials called the Synergy trial, demonstrate that for people who are at relatively low risk, they have one or two vessels that are blocked, they're in pretty good shape otherwise, that angioplasty and stenting is just as good as surgery in terms of outcome at 5 years. And so for most people who are in that category, stenting will relieve their symptoms just as well, and they won't have to go through the discomfort of having open heart surgery. For the highest risk patients, people who have poor heart function, who have had previous heart attacks, who have uncontrolled diabetes, that trial suggested that probably bypass surgery is best for those.
And how successful are today's stents?
The chances if you go in for an elective stent and coming out with the stent in the right place, getting excellent blood flow, and having a good long-term result for more than 5 years is more than 95%. The next generation of stents will probably be these polymer stents without metal, but that have a drug elution on them to prevent the development of restenosis. And that's where we're heading probably in the next 3 to 5 years.